Yep, are we live? Okay, well, thank you for coming to the Impact Hub King's Cross, and thank you for those who are watching or following online. If you're watching or following online, you know that you can ask questions via Twitter or via the blog, and Jeff Kanesovich will be taking notes and sharing your questions with the rest of us. So just to introduce myself, I'm Enrique Mendizabal. I run on think tanks, and I'll be moderating today. But we have I'll go around the room. Maybe you want to introduce yourselves.
Sure. Yep. Awesome. Yeah. Okay. So I'm John Chilingirian, and I am a PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge, and I study think tanks. I'm also a research manager at Public World, which is based at the Hub.
Great. Hello everyone, I'm Rosie Clayton. Got a wide range of experience from across politics and policy. Currently a kind of an educational consultant, but also scoping out, setting up think tanks in Manchester for the moment, kind of innovation units and things like that. So.
Thank you.
I'm Brendan Martin. I run I'm the managing director of a social enterprise called Public World.
Thanks. Okay, my name is Marcus. I'm also a PhD candidate at the University of Cambridge, studying think tanks and the economic crisis.
And I'm Jeff Kanesovich. I work with on think tanks.
Okay, thank you. So what we have today is we call it a pre-launch, because we're going to have over the months of September and October, we're going to have a series of online webinars looking at different research methods to study think tanks. And this idea emerged from conversations with Jordan and Marcus about their own work while doing their PhDs, and the fact that there is quite a growing interest from think tanks and from funders and from those interested in public policy to learn more about this type of organization. So the series will allow us to showcase a few research methods. Will it be a chance to discuss them, but we thought that this pre-launch event could be an opportunity to have a conversation among peers live, and we're recording it so that we can share it with others in the future. So today it's a discussion. It's as open as we can, and we have a new participant, new guest. Richard? Do you wanna say hi to the public online?
I just tweeted this link. Hello, live stream. I'm Richard Darlington. I'm head of news at IPPR, and I'm about to move to Kenya to work for a company called Well Told Story, who work with think tanks and research organisations across East and Southern Africa.
Thank you. Okay, we lost you now. But. Okay, so I was just giving an introduction about the topic. So today what we're going to do is we're going to have a conversation. Jordan and Marcus have prepared a kind of a discussion paper, which is really a discussion brief. I should add that maybe online is Andrea Ordóñez as well, who's a researcher based in Ecuador and a long-time think tanker, and she's also been working with us on this, and so she'll have a bigger role in the series as we go on. Marcus and Jordan have prepared this brief discussion document, and we'll go over it. We have three key questions to ask. What is this thing that we study? You know, what are our think tanks? What kind of questions do we want to know about? You know, do we want the answer for? And what kind of methods are there out there that we could use? The answers to these questions should feed into a series starting in September. And just, if anybody has just joined us online, if you have any questions, please add them to the Twitter feed or to the comment box, and Jeff Kanesovich will be monitoring that and relaying your questions to the rest of us. Okay, so the first thing is, what is a think tank? I think anybody who's had to explain it to their friends or family, you know, you're trying to say, I work with think tanks, I'm studying think tanks, or I'm writing about think tanks, it's a hard thing to do. But we wanted to start by asking everybody here what you thought was a think tank, you know, what, if you have a definition of a think tank or a characteristic of a think tank or what might not be a think tank. We'll just open it up, and then Jordan, Marcus will kind of join in and offer a bit of a synthesis of that key question. So, there's anybody online who wants to add that, please tweet it or comment it, and we'll get to you after we have a discussion here. Okay. So, who would like to start?
It's really quickly worth saying, if you want to join on Twitter, it's using the hashtag TTMethods.
Okay. Great. Thanks. Rosie, would you like to?
Yeah. It's an interesting one because I started my career in a think tank that was quite political and kind of formed the basis for how I pursued my career in politics and policy. But for me, a think tank was always the nexus between different sort of interest groups within society, and a platform for kind of synthesizing ideas, for bringing different kind of cohorts of individuals together, and for developing policy platforms and political ideas. But it's been interesting to see over the last few years how many think tanks have become more sort of like consultancy-based and are doing specific pieces of work. And so my interest now is, can you develop a think tank that's very much action research-led and grassroots-led, that then is able to develop almost social movements that then influence political ideas? So it's not an area where I've had a huge amount of involvement in the last sort of 5 or 6 years, but for me it was always that kind of bridging point between sort of media organisations, academics, politicians, and the citizenry at the bottom. And yeah, I'm quite interested in how that you can maybe develop something that's very much citizen-led as opposed to political and policy-led, I suppose.
Okay, so a nexus, in essence,
a nexus, that kind of critical point that brings together the different strands and platform really for synthesising those ideas.
Okay, anybody else? Richard?
I don't angst over the question as much as you do, Enrique. I know you, but partly because I guess I work with a much narrower range of think tanks in a much smaller group of countries than you do. So mainly in the UK. And for me, IPPR's strapline, which is just two words, and I think a sort of forward slash, it kind of does it for me because the strapline is ideas. It used to be ideas for change, and then we just got rid of the word for and put a slash, what a graphic designer did. and for me, it sort of tells us what we are by telling us what we're not. So if we were just about ideas, we'd be academia. If we were just about change, we'd be an NGO, a campaign group, a movement, a party. But we're about the two things at the same time together.
Okay.
For the purpose, and that kind of, I think in some ways you can't define something without defining what it's not. So for me, that's sort of how I think about it.
So not just a nexus, but actually something that operates in both fields or both spaces simultaneously.
Yeah.
Has to abide by the same rule, by the rules of each of those spaces.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry. Would you like to add a?
No, thanks.
What do you think of think tank? You guys, what?
We can talk a bit about what we prepared.
Okay.
So, the first things we had was basically a list of sort of semi think tanks or think tanks that are more or less some institutions that are difficult to define as think tanks, but that can behave as think tanks sometimes. For instance, Greenpeace is a think tank. It's the RAND Corporation a think tank, the way that we understand it generally, or the OECD, which is very often referred to as a think tank. And I mean, part of the reason why we thought this series of seminars was something that was worthwhile is because there's, I think, in the literature of think tanks, any movement towards a more sort of a more nuanced understanding of what a think tank is, which actually feeds onto a lot of what you already said. So, in terms of thinking as interstitial institutions, because just to give a very quick summary of what traditional think tank studies used to do, they generally were basically part of two schools, either what was called elite theory, which basically meant that think tanks are elite actors that are connected to powerful interests, and thus are sort of a screen for actual interest, trying to convert interest into expertise. That's one tradition, very important one. And a second one was a bit less less critical than that, saying that think tanks are basically just one more actor in a crowded marketplace of ideas.
It's just quite interesting that what you both were saying, it's a hard between, and then also it has to be something more than these different constituent parts. Is really it's the framework that both Marcos and I have been using throughout our own research, and this draws on the work of sociologist Thomas Medbetz, who's looking at the emergence of think tanks in the US. So where did this term come from? Where did this organization come from? Because the traditional story is that they ended up with, well, in the UK anyway, that at some point in the 1970s these organizations appeared, and then lo and behold, the famous article was a think tank by the 90s. We start referring to organizations that in the past were just referred to by their names, such as the Institute of Physical Studies or NISA or something like that. Now they become think tanks. And it's trying to understand sort of how does this emerge, and how can such diverse organizations like our famous IT and Smith Institute, and maybe even someone like Case at the NSE, be part of this similar space?
So it doesn't. So one of the questions I had for you was, in Eastern Europe, now in Latin America, in Africa, we're finding more cases of think tanks being set up as for-profit companies. So it's much easier to set up as a limited company or as a company. You're not going to have too much hassle from the government if you are a corporation or a company. And you can have within your own status that you're going to invest most of your profits in communications or in providing a public good of information. So they're set up as companies. And they operate, they look like, in terms of the way that they work, they look like a think tank, but you look at the detail of how the structure is set up, they wouldn't be recognized as a think tank in the UK. You can ask the same thing about think tanks in China, which is a country with most think tanks after the US, but most of them would be set up within the state or would be set up within the party. They might not be recognized as think tanks in the UK, or maybe in the US, but they still call themselves think tanks.
Are we at another point of transition where think tanks are morphing into other kinds of organizations, and they're actually characteristics of think tanks are visible in all sorts of organizations that don't call themselves think tanks, such as Public World for that matter? I mean, there's element of our work which you would associate with think tank methodologies, but most of it isn't, and we don't choose to call ourselves that.
Yep.
I suppose if we wanted to, we could. And I think that applies to quite a lot of organizations, which prompts for me the question, so why does this definition matter at all?
Why does it matter? you are dedicating 5 years of your life to studying, right?
Okay.
Why does the definition matter?
Well, the purpose of this webinar series at least matters because the way that we think about think tanks is going to have an effect on how we research and understand these institutions. So for instance, if you think that think tanks are ideological structures of the powers that be, you research think tanks in a certain way. If you think that think tanks are more like research, policy research institutes, you're going to research, for instance, their research capacity. Or for instance, if you think that the main aim of think tanks and what defines think tanks is the fact that they try and impact public policy, you're going to try and assess their impact on public policy. So, I mean, I agree with you that, in a sense, that one of the great innovations of the metrics framework is precisely that it allows think tanks a certain flexibility. So, basically occupying an institutional place between different fields, media, academia, economics and business world, and politics. And in that sense, actually, that allows that flexibility, the fact that they occupy institutional space, allows them to be quite flexible in actually what resources they focus on or not. So, yeah, in that sense, as I understand it, the aim of these seminar series is at least to try and tease out that think tanks are all of these things and all of the above. And that actually, the way that we understand them is going to have an effect on how how we use different methods to research them.
Just come back to what Brendan was saying, why does it matter? What's the value? Maybe what's the value of the term? I think it has value in the fact that people still want to use it. And it has value that IPPR will still call itself a think tank. So it has some sort of value that a group will turn up and define themselves through that term for some reason. We might want to work out why.
Yeah.
And maybe we'd like to know the methods about what is it about, why do organisations do just want to brand themselves certain.
Or like NEF, for example, rather absurdly calls itself a think and do tank, which is on the one hand very deliberately trying to distinguish itself from a think tank, but at the same time trying to stay in that territory. So it is quite interesting, and it's an important term.
There's a comment from Leandro H in Argentina saying that they should at least do two things, which is to research and try to influence policy. Would that be a valid minimum set of characteristics?
Yeah, I think there's a series of spectrums in there on which you can plot think tanks. So you said, do you look at them as sort of evidence based or politically ideological? Mm-hmm. Well, there's definitely a spectrum, and you could plot a variety of think tanks on the spectrum. And equally, they have lots of different business models as well. So some organisations I've worked with, and I've said, look, basically what you're doing is operating like a think tank. And they say, but we can't call ourselves a think tank, because actually a big part of what we do is we have funds and we invest funds, so we act like a funder. And that's, that's what think tanks have. That's not what think tanks are. So, and like in the UK, for example, Joseph Rowntree Foundation, more and more try to position themselves as a think tank because they see it will be beneficial. Brand, but their business model does include a large, sort of funding arm where they're commissioning research from other think tanks and other people that aren't think tanks as well. Mm-hmm. So I think you've got different business models, and one thing we found through WANTCOMS is the variety of business models. Once you sort of open the hood and start looking at different think tanks,
absolutely fascinating.
For example, don't have human research people. They just have researchers. They mainstream communications through their work. So one of the big sort of structural splits of the staff is a lot of don't follow something, and reform might not be. So I think there's sort of spectrum in terms of the way there's different business models, and even within organizations. I mean, Demos and IPPR, for example, I think they're very, very similar organizations. I've worked with them. Again, their staffing structure is completely different from others that are there. So Demos is just about less than 10 researchers who are plus staff. And the ratio of interns to researchers was like 3 to 1. So they had 3 times as many interns as they had researchers. Very small core, a very sort of loose and constantly turning over, very bright, clever interns coming in, doing a lot of the sort of work, actually. But the fundraising was done by IPPR. A handful of interns at any one time, 40 full-time research staff on permanent contracts. So completely different in terms of staffing structures. And yet, you would think of IPPR and Demos very, very similar.
Yeah. Not going too much into the history, but like IPPR itself actually started as on the Demos model.
They're both creatures of the 90s, aren't they? They both come from the centre-left.
But in a sense, like his name now, the original director of
James Crawford.
One of his early reflections on the first couple of years of the IPPR sort of says, we'll farm out to academics to write for us.
Yeah.
Which but it's interesting. So it's gone from that sort of waha model now to being something that's
more in-house.
Actually cultivates its own experts,
yeah.
Which puts in a different category altogether, which means it runs differently, and to actually even study that organisation to compare it to someone else makes it quite fun for people like
I mean, quite a few think tanks now have big associate networks, don't they? So bringing different levels of expertise for specific projects. Maybe the opposite model of that intern base, because obviously internships are now basically quite difficult territory, but bringing a wide range of networks to help support that core activity, which is quite interesting.
So as long as you fulfil some functions, how you fulfill them, how you structure, how you're staffed, how you manage, might not be that important. As long as you are
managing to produce research or produce advice.
How you're funded as well. Mm-hmm.
How you're funded. Oh, yeah. Yeah. But, yes, we have a new person. Sorry, I'll break for short break for introduction, and you can join the conversation. We're discussing the question of what is a think tank. What's your name?
My name is Alia. I'm a PhD student at the School of Environmental Studies, and I'm looking at educational reforms in the UK, particularly in relation to secular religious education. There's been quite a bit written on what is like think tanks, and I'm looking at focusing on think tanks as a source of discourse on the area, which is why I came into it.
Okay, good. How do you define think tanks in your sector? How have you identified them?
I haven't found any, sort of in terms of the research I've looked at, there's no agreed upon definition, but I there's sort of what sounds as if it's a sort of lowest common denominator definition that, I'm sorry, I don't know your name, that you mentioned, of producing research and having an intention to influence policy sounds like something that would unite a lot of the, and that would probably distinguish them from people, from outfits that call themselves research foundations or, other kind of...
Just advocacy groups, maybe, or a consultancy.
Just to quickly jump in, I see James Georgolakis from IDS has suggested that think tanks don't have a monopoly on doing research and engaging in policy. NGOs, donors, research organizations, and university faculty also do this. So I think that not only are we finding that there's a fuzzy definition of what a think tank is, but actually that there's probably a lot of other organizations out there doing think tank-like work. And I work in think tank communications, and one of the things that I'm even finding is, especially with, Guardian across the street has a data blog now, and you have start getting some even journalists that are starting filling some of those roles in a way that they didn't maybe even 3 years ago.
So some people talk about a think tank function or a think tanky function, or say, or they refer, oh, we have a think tank in the company, or we're like a think tank for the sector, for the state, or so. I think the term think tank is also being used to describe just a function, a role, an area within our organization related to research, to learning, to promoting change, which. Mm-hmm. It's very I think it's very complicated for someone who runs a blog called On Think Tank. but I'm sure it makes it complicated for those studying them and exciting for those consulting and working with them and trying to set them up. I know we can talk about this for ages. I have been doing that for a long time, but I want to move on to the next question. So we kind of resolved the issue of exactly what is a think tank. I think we're looking at their functions and try to identify them. And recognizing that there's diversity. But the next question we want to know, we want to address, and Marcos made a comment about this, is depending on the definition, we might ask different questions. So we like to know from you guys, who have been studying think tanks, what are the questions that have been asked so far, or that tend to be asked more often? Mm-hmm. And then ask the rest of you, and those online as well, what are questions should be asked? What are the questions that we should be asking about think tanks? So, Marcos and Jordan. So
I think, aside from the question, what is a think tank, which that's the bane in everyone's life, especially in the academic community. Books have been written about that, and are still being written. Question is usually around influence, and what was the impact of a think tank in this particular time. So. My apologies to any the international audience that a lot of my examples come from the UK, but the main questions in British think tank research has been what's been the impact of, say, think tanks associated with Thatcherism on the outcomes of Thatcherism and the ideas of the Conservative Party. At the same time, not as many studies, but equally people would be interested in the impact of IPPR and Demos on the growth of New Labour, those types of questions. So it's always been about what has a set of organisations that the researcher has defined as a think tank, how they in any way impacted what happened in government or what party has been reforming. So the questions have usually been focused on the state and the party, and usually in the time of crisis and transition. And that's what most of the literature and most of the research that's been produced and is still being produced is about. It's trying to sort of go into finer detail about what's going on. So it's usually historical, documentary research, maybe a lot of maybe some interviews with expert witnesses, so you'll get the ex-director of the IPPR or something like that, or anyone you can define as the key players at the time to get an idea about what happened, what decisions were made. And at the same time, people are also interested in how policy discourses like that think tanks were generating at the time, how they transferred into government. So who was saying what, and is there sort of congruence between those two things to try and get an idea of influence and impact. And I know I've got a funny feeling that think tanks might do that themselves.
You find think tanks that found themselves in the image of other think tanks. So if you just take like three phases of British politics, like super crudely, IEA in the 80s, don't worry too much about where they came from, just acknowledge that IEA in the 80s were the place to be. And so then in the 90s, you have Demos and IPPR become the sort of centre-left version of, they try to help make the political weather. And then comes Policy Exchange again in the sort of the end of the 90s. And so in kind of three waves from right to left to back to right again, you sort of have think tanks and the people around think tanks trying to either set them up or support them in a way that they can be influential on government on broad political agendas.
What else has been there?
Yeah, so one little thing I'd like to add, because I think Jordan's summary was really good, is that generally think tanks, at least traditionally, have understood their mission as affecting both public policy and the climate of opinion, or the policy debates, however we want to define it. And that also has had an effect in the type of research that we've seen being done, particularly on actually the effect of think tanks and how, for instance, particular policy areas are covered, or which think tanks are more effective in sort of disseminating their message through the media. That's one other type of sort of research on the impact of think tanks, which think tanks themselves do as well, as far as I'm aware. And also, I mean, nowadays, particularly, I think from 2005-06 almost, particularly after the crisis, has been more work on think tanks, and it's very topical as well, the work on think tank networks that doesn't necessarily actually focus on one think tank in particular. But actually outside as well, because in a sense, if you're studying what a think tank is, very often it doesn't make much sense to actually ask the think tank itself. Actually, you'd like to ask, for instance, a policy advisor to government, for instance. That's all I want to ask.
I think there's also a growing number of studies which look at discrete policy areas, like the Oxford's a very good example of that. But there's lots of studies now about education policy networks and think tanks' role in bringing ideas to that, or what their function in these policy networks are. And they go across, you name the policy area, there'll probably be 10 or so studies looking at that, and that just amounts since 2010.
And are there many studies about sort of looking at think tank from within? So are there many studies looking at how think tanks are managed, or how think tanks are funded, or how think tanks are staffed?
There's even an ethnography on think tanks.
Oh yes.
Yeah.
People have been doing work on that. Put my hand up and say yes. That's what I've been looking at as well.
So what has been your specific?
So the key questions my research has been looking at is how do think tanks make knowledge? That's a very broad basic question. How do they make knowledge? And then within that, taking the idea of a policy report, how's a policy report made, and then from that, that answers asked and answers now questions about funding.
Okay.
About advice and about authorship.
Okay, so you're looking at the research project,
the research process
yeah, as your units of analysis.
I conduct social network analysis, and so I've looked at it. I've conducted social network analysis of the funding networks which 27 think tanks in the UK have drawn on to make their products over since 2005 to 2012.
Okay.
So then also who authors this, and also who advises that, and so you can build a picture of the think tank scene and what knowledge is valued by think tanks, whose money is valued by think tanks.
Okay.
And what type of authors are valued by think tanks? Are they all in-house? Do they connect certain groups? Do we find interesting connections?
So these are all very interesting specific questions. Yeah. Looking out to the list.
Yeah.
And what about your questions? What are your questions?
Yeah, I also study think tanks. Not so much the rent directly think tanks themselves. So my question is, how did the 2008 economic crisis affect their work, and both institutional and intellectual terms? So I use interviews, a lot of document analysis, to look at basically movements of people on the one hand, changes in the organizational structure, changes in the policy areas that they focus on, and changes on the policy discourse and the way that they try and position themselves in the public domain. So actually, where also in which sort of venues are they more likely to try and enter across these years? For instance, a central left think tank would have a really interesting opportunity around 2009, which is historical, on trying, try and offer an alternative narrative of actually what went wrong. And a traditional free market think tank would try and defend the idea of the market, for instance.
Okay.
Yeah.
What do you all think might be important questions to ask about think tanks?
Well, I think the influence of political interests, not just in being influenced by them, but in influencing the think tanks themselves. In other words, the relationship between them is a two-way one, even at the point of which I'm sure the network analysis will have shown, but also even in terms of setting them up. I mean, I can't quite remember how the IPPR was set up, but it was pretty clearly taking note of the impact of IEA and perhaps ASI on Thatcher's policy package and thinking, we need that on the Labour side. And of course, it was Labour Party leaders that set it up, in effect, wasn't it?
Well, Patricia Hewitt was the first member of staff, and she was the deputy director, and she had previously worked for Neil Kinnock. So it was definitely a connection to Labour and opposition in the 80s.
And whereas Demos was a product of the Eurocommunist movement, really, wasn't it, initially? And it's morphed quite a bit since then. So it's, I mean, you could argue that both those think tanks, don't know about IEA, had their origins as much as in political decisions.
Yeah, and in France, it's more than hugely influential setting up policy exchange as well. So,
if you look at the history of think tanks in the US, you can look at different stages where think tanks would have emerged from academia. They've emerged from policymakers, from technocrats. They've emerged from politicians. So they've emerged from PR communications of the corporate sector. Depending on the decade you're in, you can look at who's founded them. You know, they've come from the elite that is leading or that is more in power at the time. But that's a good question. So not just ask the influence of a think tank on politics or on policy, but also a good question to ask is what's the effect of politics or interests or ideology on the think tanks themselves.
And following in on that, we have an interjection from Boris Kudar, who's at the Training Center of Human Rights Advocacy in Ukraine, who suggests that most of the think tanks there, at least, are NGOs or governmental governmental NGOs. Can you do that? Apparently in Ukraine you can do that. And therefore we need to be looking at methods for exploring how authorities control think tanks and use them for their own advocacy.
Yeah, so not just treat them as completely autonomous or independent or able to take control.
I mean, just in case anybody wanted another research project, I'd be fascinated to see research projects about think tanks that didn't survive. Because in some ways, like, we're discussing all the think tanks that did, you know, IPPR is 25 years old. So what about all the think tanks that came and went in those 2.5 decades? You know, we only really talk about the ones that kind of.
Why did they fail? Or maybe they didn't fail. Maybe they just fulfilled a very specific group.
Something else. Or yeah. How did they evolve? Was it
the evolution of the evolution of the history of think tank communities, or the evolution of think tanks? Mm-hmm. There's a very good. I always quote it from Chile, Jeffrey Poulier, who used to work at the Ford Foundation in Santiago for many years. And he wrote an excellent book about the evolution of think tanks in Chile and the role in helping to bring about the return to democracy. And it tells a long story. It starts in the 50s with investments in higher education all the way to well, the 90s. So it's an interesting look at how did think tanks contribute to change, but also how did they evolve. There's another comment here from Shannon Sutton, who works for the Think Tank Initiative. She's from IUS. They funded work on the context and how the context affects think tanks, and I think that kind of goes in line with what we were saying. What about you? What questions?
Yeah, I'm interested in how think tanks distinguish their output from academia.
Okay.
And how they distinguish it from academia, but from what they may deem lesser organisations or kind of non, what they would regard as fellow think tanks, like charities. I don't know, third sector, third sector initiatives and the like. There is a lot of conversation within academia about making sure academic research is distinguishable from think tanks, mm-hmm. particularly because policy and government expectations are moving more and more towards bringing academic research closer to what think tanks produce, and this huge emphasis on impact and utility.
Which is being asked from academia. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
And the latest research assessment exercise includes this very much, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And academics will follow that funding.
Yeah. So they're being pushed towards the sort of the think tank direction. That's interesting because if you look at many developing countries where academic institutions are fairly weak, think tanks emerge as an alternative, and so they present themselves as academics. So many think tanks in Latin America and Africa and South Asia would present themselves as organizations that produce academic quality research, and they have systems in place to try to ensure academic quality sort of standards. Yeah. The question I always ask is, what's appropriate for a think tank in terms of academic standards or research standards? What's okay for a think tank to produce that maybe might not be okay for a research department within a university.
I'm can I just interject briefly on that subject? I think that's such an important point. I was at a seminar a few weeks ago. I told Jordan this at SOAS, in fact, which was organised to discuss a particular subject which we've done quite a lot of work on, and that's why we were invited. And basically, it was mainly academics from SOAS and other institutions, plus me, plus a few people from NGOs, international NGOs, one of whom said, what we want is, when the conversation got round to what the collaboration could consist of next, one of them said, well, what we want is policy-based evidence. And I thought, well, that's not surprising coming from an NGO. That's what I want, if the way NGOs have gone lately. But what shocked me was that none of the academics said, well, you've come to the wrong place then. The assumption was that this whole thing about impact would have the effect, had indeed driven them in that direction so far that they weren't even resisting that notion. And I thought, maybe I'm a little naive, undoubtedly, probably, but I found that incredibly shocking. And it's perhaps another dimension of the impact of think tanks is how it is affecting the methodologies and the ethos of academia. Because I for one want my academics in the ivory tower, actually. That's where I think they belong. I don't want them to stay there. I don't want them to take no interest in the world, but I want their interest in the world to be informed by research questions coming out of academic discourse.
We could connect that to a think tank discussion that is that I think is also very important, and is how different business models, how different funding conditions maybe which demand impact, which demand, you know, to demonstrate that they've had an impact, actually affect the practices of the organizations, the values of the organizations. So many organizations that might have intended to be independent or at least intellectually autonomous, if they want to access the funds they need to survive, they're going to have to choose certain issues to study, they're going to have to choose certain methods or work with certain people simply to be able to continue to get those funds. And maybe ask the questions that the policymakers want them to ask rather than the questions they think that should be asked. So again, I think we're going back to the how do these different elements of context affect think tanks?
I think in academia, like science subjects have always had this distinction between basic and applied research. And you know that different funding councils fund different things. It's very clear, are you doing basic research in science or are you doing applied? You know, and for that, whereas in social science, we don't sort of have that. I mean, we might have a sort of, you know, I'm doing theory, and that's sort of, you know, if you're sort of self-defining in academia as, you know, focusing on theory, you're sort of sending out a message that you're not necessarily expecting impact with it. But actually, it's actually political theory sometimes that's the most sort of influential, particularly on quite ideological things. But I saw someone speak from a unit that UCL have set up, which is about public policy for science and technology. So it's academics who are doing, so I'll look them up in a minute and get their name, but they're from science disciplines. They're interested in public policy questions now which are dealing with technology, because so many public policy questions like health is about sort of wearable technology and social care and aging is so much about what technological and engineering solutions can be applied, and there's such a big sort of synergy now between sort of public policy and that UCL have seen this niche and thought we'll set up a unit which is about public policy on science and technology, so that their academic stream brings in people with science and technology sort of expertise, but what they want to do is dock with public policy experts or people who are making public policy, or and the reason they're talking to IPPR is because they think we've got experience of implementing public policy, even though we haven't really done anything on science and technology. So it's an interesting sort of coming together of interests, or previously separated interests.
I mean, and that ties in with the growth of the think tank as a brand. So,
yeah.
I mean, one of the things I've been interested in is why are so many organisations starting to self-identify as a think tank?
Yeah.
About that brand? And similarly, you were talking about how think tank, the brand, is impacting on academia. I've seen that in terms of government. So think of Policy Lab in the Cabinet Office. I've been working with Oldham Local Authority to think about setting up an innovation unit across North Manchester, but which is basically a think tank by another name. So you now see local authorities setting up their own little impact units. I mean, it's about public service reform ultimately, and political discourse within that locality. But yeah, it's really interesting how that brand is emerging in quite a strong way. And I'd be interested to see other kind of common characteristics of all think tanks. I mean, could you have a framework of a think tank is sort of five or six different characteristics? I'm not sure. Probably not from the discussion we've had. But, you know, in terms of, you know, what is it that makes an organisation a think tank, which goes by the definition of what is a think tank?
Just to say that, going back to, and I guess slightly related to that, but also going back to more what you were saying, Brendan, we have a couple of comments from Hans Goodbrod, who is at Transferify based in Georgia, where he is asking, should evidence be policy-based? I'm not quite so skeptical. Research is always interested, as philosophy of science has shown. So I think we're getting a little bit there in terms of how ivory tower can you really be? And he adds that one difference is that science often demands 95% confidence, but policy doesn't get that luxury. So I think there's some questions in there, perhaps.
Mm. That's interesting. I'm just the last couple of things we were all saying, it seems that the questions that people are so interested in are influence, but it's maybe the researchers need to move away from looking at influence on one sector. It's maybe not so much, of course the questions of think tanks' effect on politics. We are interested in that. We're always going to be interested in that. There's always going to be a bit of muckraking involved because we want to know who was there and what happened. But actually, we're more interested in the issues of the wider environment. So what is the think tank's impact on how the media works, how universities are working, and also, it's almost like, on the term now, but you know, diffusion of innovations, almost like the think tank itself has an innovation that's diffused. The term itself is diffused from the States to the UK, globally. What was the history of that? But also now it's in, you know, it's impacting particular sectors.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's. I don't think many people are doing that.
No.
I know we have. But no, it's quite interesting. There's lots of interesting approaches to looking at that, which would draw on a lot of the traditional methods that we've spoken about earlier.
Yeah.
But also, it does lend itself to maybe sort of a relational analysis, like looking at the networks of people who were involved in this thing, and who takes a central role, and who has coordinating powers or brokering powers within those communities.
And I think in what you're saying, it's impossible to just look at an individual organization on its own. You're always talking about a community. You're talking about a long time period of sort of historical evolution of think tanks, of people moving around. Even in the stories that Richard has suggested, looking at failed think tanks, I think that there are any. Think tank directors watching, they'd be interested to know, you know, what kind of business models have worked better in certain circumstances and not so well in others. What kind of funding models have worked better for think tanks during moments of crisis, during changes of government, during recessions, during scandals. You know, they got something wrong and backfired, and did the funding model allow them to survive or evolve? Kind of staff they've attracted. You talked about the evolution of think tanks in, you know, of the community, but that also has an implication of staff in the organization. You know, whether they're interns, whether they're associates, whether they're full time, what has been the best staff, best talent for different think tanks at different times, different moments.
Actually, another thing we didn't mention about the literature of think tanks in general is that it tends to think about them in terms of waves.
Okay.
So towards the beginning of the 20th century, there was a particular type of wave, for instance, in the US, the Carnegie Endowment. So based on philanthropy and based on a particular view of what science is. Then in the 60s, a different type of think tank. And then if we move to the UK, definitely in the 70s with CPS, IEA, and the Anson Institute, a different wave of think tanks, which I think that that signals something quite interesting about think tanks, just they are such heteronomous institutions that very small and sometimes imperceptible changes in their environment actually changes the impacts on how they behave. So for instance, there's a little research, but not enough in my opinion, on actually how social media has affected think tanks, and how they think of their role in relation to social media, for instance. And actually, trying to come back on the issue of the fact that think tanks have sort of one leg in policy and one leg in academia, or in general, that's how they are understood. The issue of independence there is precisely that that actually sometimes it's quite difficult for a think tank to go beyond the pale politically, and that is generally the issue of regarding independence or not, actually, and whether or not they allow themselves to say things that sort of try and push the Overton window. So, trying to actually say things that in other fields that they work on are not going to be palatable, but it would be in a like purely research perspective. That's generally also something that's in the environment regarding things which games are they playing, and how do you, can you play several games at the same time?
Mm-hmm. I think it also depends on who they're speaking to themselves. They might be. So they can be legitimacy even by their connections to government to say, well, we're very glad that you're making that point. Can you keep on making it, because it makes our time, makes our job a bit easier with the internal conflicts that you have within a party. And you know, so just from my research, I found that's so that some researchers have reported that, you know, when they've disseminated their work, they know it's going to be critical, but they know there's a constituent that's happy that it's critical, because it allows them to push the debate slightly on. So it's almost like the think tank, in some respects, can take a hit.
Yeah.
Say something radically right or radically left, or seen as a little bit too radical for the government of the day to be saying, but it softens up the climate of opinion, and that's very good news for what's going on in for constituents within this party. But then again, it's only maybe a certain type of think tank that would do that role. Whereas you've got the sort of the IFS of this world who just come out and clobber out statistics and the challenge the government debate, which annoys everyone.
Yeah, I think journalists call it kite flying.
Yes,
I think it's for think tanks who make policy recommendations, whereas IFS primarily just put out analysis.
Okay. I'll play the role of moving us on the agenda. The last thing we want to talk about, which will help us also to finalize the online series, which will start in September, is to do with the research methods. So we've discussed the definition of think tanks, we've discussed the kind of questions that we think might be interesting to ask. Now, what kind of methods could we be using? And we thought what we'll do is we'll ask Jordan and Marcus to just very briefly kind of describe their methods. You've already alluded to them briefly, and then ask you if you know, and especially you doing a PhD as well. So, what kind of methods or research tool do you find particularly? Have you found particularly useful to or would use to study think tanks? And we'll see what those online have to say as well. Our idea is that at the end of the series, we'll be able to put a bit of a compilation of methods, briefs, like two pagers, so that anybody trying to look at think tanks might have a guide on what tools to use. So, Jordan, you want to go?
Yeah, so as I think Jordan said, I use social network analysis, mixed methods, like quantitative network analysis, also talk to think tank researchers about their own personal networks and how they build their personal networks and maybe some of the conflicts they come into when they're doing their research. So, pressure from the funder, pressure from the boss, pressure from the people that are the civil servants or party people they're trying to sell their ideas to. But part of just the quantitative side, I used what were very typical social network measures, and I collected that data from using think tank documents. So, going to the title page, who funded this, turning the next page, who authored it, going to the next page, who did they mention the thank yous, and then from that you can build up. You'll find that what we're talking about, the think tanks being situated in the space between different professions, you see all these different professions coming together and being enrolled to create the think tank piece of research, and you can see that it's, and then within that, when you go across a broad enough sample, you can actually see, well, no, some think tanks are more hybrid than others. Mm-hmm. A think tank like the IFS talks to other IFS type people, whereas a think tank, maybe say like the IPPR, will talk to a whole host of individuals, political, non-political, people like the IFS, but it's not maybe not such a two-way relationship, so it gives you a definite sort of two-tier to the space of think tanks in the UK. So that's the methods that I use. So pretty simple in the sense that you're freely available, you can find these publications everywhere, but a rich source of information. But at the same time, I know people use, like, it might be, I can't say something about content analysis of publications.
That's not what I do, but you can also do content analysis, which is basically quantitative measures of the language that are used in their reports, which of course will vary from institution to institution.
And what's the method you're using for your study?
Okay, so the question I want to answer is how think tanks were affected by the crisis intellectually and institutionally. So I mainly use interviews and document analysis. In terms of the interviews, I tend to ask think tankers, are they formally employed by actually just four case studies? Basically, to tell me a story on how the think tank developed around that time, and to try and cross-check that, I do extensive research on, for instance, like the Charity Commission, the Companies House, also look at their appearances in the media, and movements of people, of course. That on the one hand, and on the and I use documents basically as a unit to take a look at first what's the source of the funding. I mean, if it's sometimes it's fiscal, sometimes it's not. Also, the research area they focus on and how that changed over time, so it has a quantitative element. And also the type of arguments they the types of position that they're trying to make in the public domain. So are they thinking of themselves as experts, as interpreters of others, as mediators between different communities, etc. And one thing that I found very briefly is first that the way that they understand their independence has a lot to do with the business model.
Mm-hmm.
So for instance, a think tank that operates on a commission basis thinks that it can't be bought in the sense that they have their own core set of values. Whereas I think that gets more core funding, for instance, would say they are independent because they can research whatever they want.
Yeah.
Then on the one hand, different definitions of independence depend on the business model. And also that, particularly after the crisis, around 2012-13, I've gotten the impression that a lot of think tanks have started to think a bit more actively about what's their own role in the policy debate.
What about your method? What kind of methods are you using? What tools are you using?
I'm studying primarily educational institutions, so think tanks aren't the focus of, they're not the centre of my research, but I will be looking at them as a source of output on educational work,
right,
and on educational reform in the UK, which is it's a discussion in the public sphere a lot, it's in politics a lot, and so I will be going down the content analysis route.
Okay.
We do content analysis of the publications and
but not just for think tanks.
Yeah, that's true. By intellectual output by think tanks on education, and by for example, teaching unions,
yeah,
academics, media.
What are the main sort of barriers you find or difficulties in doing this type of research, content analysis?
I need to map out where the different concerns are coming from. There's an awful lot of different voices and different priorities and agendas in the debate, and just looking at think tank outputs will be skewing the discussion. I mean, it's very rich and fruitful kind of sector to look at, but I definitely need to broaden it out and sort of in a way, understand the ecosystem of what's going on in the discourse about education.
So to look at their influence, you need to look at the influence of everybody else,
yeah,
rather than just
yeah,
their work.
Yeah.
So, and I mean, you're using a lot of online material, right?
Mm-hmm.
So one of the things I can imagine somebody in a developing country, which I will be going to work in Africa soon, will find is that not everything that think tanks produce around the world goes online. Whereas I think we come to expect that in the UK, nothing will be produced, won't be put online as soon as they can. In many cases, that process takes a lot longer, and documents are not produced to be published online, or if they are, they're published late, etc. So is that, would that make it impossible or very difficult to do the kind of research you're doing?
From a network perspective, no. I decided to use publications for several reasons, which we'll talk about that. Maybe I'll talk about that later when I do my
yeah.
but you can generate networks through talking to someone. So I was interested, say, to the five most important people you spoke to in the last month, and then
mm-hmm.
got five of them, and I can go to the next person in the room, and then we can see if there are links between. So you can build up the policy community. You can build. So I could have built up think tank networks that way. I decided not to because I wanted the data to be public. And I wanted to actually know the relationships between people. I didn't want to have to deal with the issue of anonymity on that side of the project. So that's why I decided not to do that type of research. And also respondents rate if I sent out a questionnaire to a group of busy think tankers, would they really take time to fill it in for me? So I thought there would be other ways to do it. But it is possible, and there's different styles of network analysis, so you can look at a whole community. Or you do something like personal network analysis where you just tell, you focus on one person,
yeah,
and then you can compare different networks. Yeah. So definitely it's easy to do that offline.
In your case, if you're looking at an array of organizations, right, very different organizations in your ecosystem, some might prefer the publication as a communication tool, but others might prefer events as a communication
yeah.
tool, or direct engagement or training. So, because that those might be the places where the content is.
Yeah. It also, for me, links into the question of where authority lies.
Right.
What is authoritative knowledge? And just, for example, I mean, just apart from the research I'm doing, if you just consult any tabloid or broadsheet article reporting some new, I don't know, some new debate or discovery, there will often be some kind of implicit hierarchy of experts. You know, Professor so-and-so from the University of Glasgow says whatever, and that's, it's not disputed, whereas if, you know, deputy head teacher in a city school in, you know, Birmingham says something else, it's kind of, you know, that person is a mortal.
Yeah.
You know, and where do think tanks come in, you know, in the middle of that? But very often they're, I mean, I don't know, please tell me what you guys think, but slightly much closer to the academia side of academia kind of end of the hierarchy in terms of authoritative statements. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested to know how that's considered also in academia, because it's a lot of academics sniff at think tank research and why that would be.
I think Jonathan from the IFS, mm-hmm. the presentation, one of the things he said, one of the things that felt like impact for the IFS was that the media was mentioning them as the, the independent, no, the reputable, the respected, so they're not just the IFS or the think tank, but
with this adjective.
The adjective that says not just another organization, and I think that probably has to do with the policy community where you are. You know, you'll have different hierarchies of authority depending on the different places.
I think also the context as well. So he was talking about the election period.
Yeah, exactly.
A point at which everything becomes massively contestable because, you know, the ballot papers are about to be issued. That is the point at which IFS sort of magically rises above this transcendent sort of plane of indisputability and, you know, you can't trust politicians most of the time, you definitely can't trust them just for an election. Right? So again, I think the media needs the contrast to the point where, you know, you really can't trust them. In order to give the readers and the audience and the consumers some certainty, you need to create something else.
Yeah.
So, whereas Jonathan's point was we weren't doing anything different in the election that we had done 4 years before.
Marcus,
just
another example of that. NISA, right after the economic crisis, they became all of a sudden actually massively popular. They were quoted throughout the media, looking at actually the forecasts and actually what was happening with the economy. At the moment, precisely in which economists were constantly questioned, which is actually quite interesting, about how think tanks have to portray themselves as experts in a moment in which actually there's contested sort of experts all around you, on the one hand. And on the other, thinking about how your previous question, how the internet itself affects the dissemination of think tanks. I think that in a context where if there were no internet, for instance, that affects the public of a particular publication, actually, and how that publication is disseminated. So, for instance, I would imagine that if there was no internet, think tanks would be a bit more elite, more sort of geared towards the
a few people with power.
Yes, exactly. And in a sense, that opacity to the public will grant it more authority, maybe. I'm hypothesizing. I don't know. Yeah. So it has to do with authority. Also has to do with dissemination and transparency or opacity.
But just another thing, going back to we were talking about the IEA, there is actually a book about the history of the IEA, which is almost like a story of two halves. But they toil away in the 1970s and are completely ignored. And then in the 1980s, say exactly the same thing they said in the 1970s. It's just that now the stars have aligned. And actually, that's another interesting thing about think tanks, that if you evaluate them over a very short period of time, you sort of miss those moments. And you sometimes think, well, you know, what's the sort of interaction between influence here? Is it the government are, you know, like setting the agenda for think tanks, and then think tanks are sort of filling in the agenda?
Or is it that actually there are some think tanks who are like out there in the wilderness who are just kind of banging on right now who are completely irrelevant, but like in 5 or 10 years' time, their moment will come and then they'll, you know, they'll be magically suddenly influential. So there is a big sort of question there, sort of who's got the agency here. For
so we're looking at the question of influence, history, right? Historical analysis, historical methods might actually come in quite handy to tell a story, tell a history rather than just a story of change, which is what often funders ask their grantees to do.
And also changing forms of influence. So if you look, for example, at the Adam Smith Institute, which also had been toiling away in the 70s, and you know, banging on about privatization before anybody else was, and they, you know, really marginalized. All of a sudden, their policies become Thatcherite policies. They get on a roll for reasons that are partly ideological, partly pragmatic. But for whatever reason, the ASI is suddenly seen as massively influential on government at a time when privatization and other forms of state restructuring are catching on all over the world, because privatization was actually driven not by the ASI but by the logic of globalization. And all of a sudden they're in this very strong position. What do? They set up a consultancy firm, Adam Smith International, which later decides actually slightly toxic brand that Adam Smith Institute, because actually they were slightly out there and we now want to be more, position ourselves more mainstream. But the technocratic outlook, the worldview that informs the technocracy of the Adam Smith International, is essentially not much different from the worldview that that informed the Adam Smith Institute. So it became a technocratic influence rather than an ideological influence, and but became a massively important international influence. So I think that, that long-term study needs to also see the different forms of influence and form and structure that evolves over a long period.
And you mentioned ethnography?
Yes, so actually getting involved on the ground and inside an organisation can open up very interesting in any organisation study.
Yeah.
You know, you can get brilliant insights. I remember what I was going to do an ethnography. I did a participant observation of a think tank, my master's. And someone warned me, won't that be like watching paint dry? Because you are just going to be a room of people on computers, and maybe someone might go say a joke. Or have you seen this online? But actually getting involved in an organization, going along to meetings, seeing who talks to who, actually seeing the micro politics that take place, actually what is the director doing? Those types of questions, which you can only get from that granular on the ground observation.
Yeah.
And actually building up the culture of an organization, not just relying on the official publications, not just relying on the media presentation, but also seeing how the constituent parts of the organization come together. It's fascinating.
Yes. And actually, I mean, I've had to go to offices of think tanks, and offices already say a lot about the
think
tank. The layout, actually who's there.
How the teams are all structured, how closely they work together, that kind of thing.
Any other comments? Jeff, anything online you think we should add?
A lot of the comments online don't have specific questions about methods, so if we're focusing on the method,
I mean, there's quite a few on surveys that it can be quite tricky for understanding think tanks.
Yeah. I mean, have we got much into, is ethnography the only way of understanding things like the management practices of a think tank? I mean, because I think that's one of those perhaps less studied areas, and I don't know if that's just because it's difficult and secretive.
Well, in the meantime, you can always interview people and go through an organisation, slice through the different layers, and in the same way that I could imagine consultants would come in and they're looking to restructure an organisation.
Staff surveys are increasingly popular in a way with large think tanks, just as a corporation would do the same.
I mean, I imagine that this is sort of a replication of a lot of debates that happen within social sciences and social science methods. And I mean, within qualitative methods broadly, the advantage that ethnography would give, of course, is that it gives you, it allows you to know, for instance, in an interview, very often you
very often you're always sort of thinking in the back of your mind, is this person actually trying to position himself or herself? With an ethnography, if you spend enough time, you'll see contradictions, you'll see change, you'll see all yep. the rest of it. Of course, the issue with ethnography is, of course, that it's very limited sampling. There's issues with access, of course,
mm-hmm.
and it's very difficult to do. Like, if you want to do historical analysis, it's very difficult as well. So every method has. I think ethnography would have a lot to add, but it's very difficult for practical reasons. And also, there are things that ethnography doesn't answer.
I think the best participant observation you can do on a think tank is that they're away day. A lot of think tanks have annual away days, and in some ways, annual away days are self-manufactured crises. Because they're in sort of steady state. Well, I'm sure this is the same for lots of other organisations, but they're in sort of steady state, like most of the time, and they kind of run on rails, but they only focus on what needs to get done. And then you take some of the most reflective people, like who work in think tanks, and then you make them self-reflect, and you get them away, you get a manufactured crisis where they all of a sudden have to have this existential moment. Thinking about what's it all for, why are we doing it? And so if you go to enough away days as well, especially for the same think tank, you sort of see Groundhog Day. So if you're only going to go to a couple of think tank meetings, like you go to just go to the away days if they'll let you in, because that's the moment at which it's so
reflect. Now we know why you're going to Africa.
Okay, we have another comment from Sharon Sutton. She works for the Think Tank Initiative, so they have almost 50 grantees around the world, and they use cases and stories, so short cases, stories of influence. So you look at a particular influencing event, and the think tanks try to explain the role they played in that process, wouldn't mind me saying that, because I was working in Rapid as one of the people who put this approach forward, is that it overemphasizes the role research think tanks play in the process. So you, by looking at everybody else as well as think tanks, can kind of even things out a little bit more. And the long history approach that you recommended would give you a sense of influence in a much more realistic way. So you might.
Yeah. At TTI, I've got three absolutely fantastic videos of
influence.
Brilliant. Do you know what I would love to see? I would love to see three videos of where it didn't work. Where you get a TTI think tank saying, do you know what, we tried this and it went wrong and it didn't work, and this is why we think it didn't work, and this is what we learned, this is what we did. So in some ways, you've got to be careful too much about championing your successes. Because think tanks kind of learn. I mean, you learn most from the projects that fail, actually. Most think tank projects are in this kind of middle bit of, it doesn't fail completely or spectacularly, certainly, but not in the short term. Neither does it sort of achieve its objectives instantly, and actually it takes a long time before you can judge was this successful or not.
Exactly.
So a lot of think tank stuff is in this.
So the ones that succeed are a minority, are the few that
those are the ones we talk about. Yeah. I think change.org have this thing called the Festival of Failure, where on a Friday on the conference call, everybody has to bring something that's gone wrong, and it's a light-hearted way of sort of joking, but it does actually get them to do a constant process of self-reflection and of sharing failures and talking and evaluating. And again, just because think tanks are on rails a lot of the time and all their incentives are to, talk up your influence, talk about how you're influential, that stuff gets, never gets surfaced.
Okay, well, I'm mindful of time, and that if you want to watch the video later on, more than an hour is quite a bit. So, but I wanted to thank you for those who came to King's Cross for this, I thought, very interesting discussion. For those who are online, what we're going to do is, the video is going to be online. It's online already. We'll put together a little brief. Jordan and Marcos are going to take some of these notes and the video, and we're going to incorporate it into this sort of discussion brief that we brought to inform the discussion. And then we'll be announcing towards the end of the week or beginning of next week details of the webinar series starting in September. If you or anybody watching online would like to still send a methods brief or tell us about something, please do. We might not be able to give you a session, but we certainly can try to bring you in to have a conversation. The idea is that each one of these webinars will be an opportunity for one person or two, you know, to present a method, describe it, and for those who are interested in learning about the method, to ask questions, to share their own experiences using those methods or others similar to them. Then we'll record that, we'll put it together, and we'll share it to others to watch and to read later on. Okay? Great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Andrea, for helping us set up, if you're still listening from Ecuador, and those who have participated, and thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Where are you going to be based in Nairobi?